time, we will get to the news center. Gary Patterson will join us. Special live news conference from our own studios, 520 James Street in downtown Wallaceburg, Ontario. We are the new 99.1 FM CKXS. Don't go anywhere.
Thanks, everybody. It doesn't matter how old you are. You can be an infant. You can be a senior citizen. Healthcare is something that will affect you sometime in your life. And we have Jeff Wesley, Shirley Roebuck from SOS, Save Our Sydenham. As well, we have Natalie Mera from the Ontario Health Coalition. And tonight we are going to be talking what we have to do to keep the Sydenham Hospital right here in Wallaceburg. We'll start off with Jeff Wesley. Jeff, give me a little background for people who are really not up to speed. Give me a little background on exactly how we've come to this point that we are worried about losing our hospital.
Okay, thank you, Gary. First of all, I just want to thank 99.1 CKXS for giving us this opportunity. Welcome to Wallaceburg, you're a great addition. The battle for the Sydenham District Hospital really goes back many, many years, and it seems that we've always been fighting that fight to save our hospital, even going back to when we raised $2 million within our own community to save it. But currently, what we're faced is that the LHIN, the Local Health Integration Network, China Can Health Alliance to a certain extent, came forward with the Hay Report, which recommended closure of our emergency department. Our view is that if you take the emergency department out of a local hospital, you basically killed the hospital. Over the years, services have disappeared. None of those services are coming back, and we're concerned because, you know, when you look at it, let's just remember that a hospital is a fundamental part of a community. We've got a lot of effort going on in this community to increase economic development, bring in business, grow the community. How can you do that if you take out a fundamental service like healthcare, and especially emergency department care?
My personal view is that small emerges are an essential part of Ontario's healthcare. We know our place. We know we're not the big city hospitals. We know we don't have the services like London or Toronto have. But you know what we do have? We have the ability to get you where you need to go. We can stabilize you and get you where you need to go. And it's my opinion that everyone in Ontario should have that same opportunity to survive a critical illness or injury and get to where they need to go, not just those that live close to a 24/7
small
emergency.
Community hospitals that are under threat of closure, like Wallaceburg, where not only the ER but also all the inpatient beds are under threat. In fact, they've already closed the inpatient beds, as I understand. Pretty hard to run an ER without the inpatient beds. And so if they're not under immediate threat, what's happening elsewhere is a lot like here. They keep moving services out of the local hospitals until they then say, oh, they're not viable anymore, and then shut them down. It's sort of this vicious cycle of continual cuts until you finally actually lose the hospital. The problem is that virtually everywhere, and the same situation exists here, the larger hospitals that are amalgamated to the small hospitals are also facing cuts, right? The reason for the cuts is that they're in budget deficit and they have to eliminate their deficits regardless of community need. It's not attached to measured community need. And so the larger hospitals don't have the capacity to take in these rural populations that they have to take in as the small hospitals are cut. So the truth is, where we're seeing it in a major way is in the small and rural hospitals, but as those services get cut and closed down, the larger community hospitals are getting more and more overwhelmed. And in this area, Chatham simply does not have the capacity to take the patients from Wallaceburg.
Well, it's interesting to note, because you know what actually happens is that Chatham doesn't have the capacity, and a lot of times on weekends and on certain dates, they're actually sending emergency room patients to Wallaceburg. So if you close a Wallaceburg ER, what's that do to the whole system?
I look at it in very much along those same lines, but I also look at the fact that if you look at what took place at eHealth, the WSIB, the consultants and the expenses, you add to that the bureaucracy of the LHIN, the bureaucracy of the Chatham Kent Health Alliance, the bureaucracy of the Ministry of Health, and there's far too many dollars going to non-healthcare related activities. As far as I'm concerned,
give me examples. Give me some examples.
You know, well, look at the LHIN. They talk about the fact that it's somehow local and it's, you know, reflective of us. It's not. We don't have a local rep on the LHIN. And that's a layer of bureaucracy that has to be paid for. Those kind of expenses, I think they should be reducing those, and they should be putting those dollars into direct health care services in hospitals for the citizens of Ontario who pay for these.
What are some of the solutions that we can have to this problem?
Well, I think one of the first things is that there is a total disjunct between As I said, the sort of values and priorities of normal Ontarians, and then the decision makers at Queen's Park in Toronto. And the government, in response to a major protest we held last April, and people came in from Wallaceburg and they bussed in from Strathroy and all over the province, really thousands of people came to Toronto to protest the cuts and closures, threatened closures of small and rural hospitals. And in response, the government announced a rural and northern health panel to look at solutions, to look at what the options are and so on. And we all understood, and Marie von Bommel came back into the community and other government MPPs came back into the communities, and they told their constituents that the government had named this panel in response to the concerns about cuts and closures of local hospitals. So we understood that there would finally be a kind of third-party review of this policy. It's not clear at all that if you close down small hospitals that you're going to save any money anyway. You've got to lay off all the staff. You have to renovate the other existing hospitals. The last round of restructuring under Harris actually cost $3.8 billion to close hospitals and lay off staff, money that was just lost to the health system, right? So we don't want to do that again. And so the government announced this panel, but on October 15th, so just last week, 2 weeks ago now, it came out with the mandate for the panel, and the mandate doesn't even mention the word hospitals. And although we've asked the minister's office several times that the panel actually go on the road, travel to these communities, hear from people about their ideas, things like Jeff Wesley was saying, reduce the amount of administration, focus getting the money actually to the front lines of care, listen to patients, workers in this system about what their ideas are for improving the system, also listen to their concerns about what happens when they lose local services, and take into account the values and the priorities and the ideas of Ontarians, especially in the communities affected. Unfortunately, now we have the mandate, the government has released the mandate of this rural and northern panel, which is supposed to report to the Minister of Health, and there's no planned public consultation. The mandate is just really to do what they call an environmental scan. It's like a literature review, which the bureaucracy could do. It's already done anyways. I mean, really what the panel needs to do is do what we were asking, a third-party review of this policy, look at it, and bring some recommendations forward to the minister that hopefully have some independence from the people in the Ministry of Health that keep fomenting this same policy over and over again of trying to close the small rural.
When we talk about the rural and northern healthcare panel, I want to point out that we had asked for a local representative beyond that panel, and we didn't get one. So it is crucial that that panel come into Wallaceburg and sit down and listen to the people, listen to those concerns, and get an understanding of what rural emergency services and rural hospital services mean in the actual communities. Watch, because we're going to have some things coming up where we're going to get, you know, be working to get our message out. We've got some space donated at 360 James Street. We're going to be putting some information up there. We're looking on a working on a 1-800 number so that people can call in and get their concerns put out. But I want to read something, a paragraph. I wrote a letter to the Minister of Health, Deb Matthews, and I just want to read the last paragraph in that thing because I think it really sums it up. And it says, and this is to the Minister of Health, if you look at the recent spending scandals at eHealth, WSIB, and others, we are convinced that if your government stops these abuses, which we think they can, then this funding should be designated to maintain vital health care services in rural and northern communities, like Wallaceburg, Dresden, Walparthen, Port Lambton, and Sombre, and in hospitals such as Sydenham District. The people of these communities made huge sacrifices to not only build, but also to support this hospital, which, by the way, came into the Chatham County Health Lines debt-free, and it should not be allowed to die a slow death just because of an inability of others to properly manage taxpayers' money. In terms of community support for our local hospital, we have done nothing wrong, but we have done everything right, and we should not be punished because of that.